bone, and these bones are important for whole human body. So like heart, the heart is also an organ which is also an important part of the human body. But this, all these tissues are mainly divided into four basic types, and these four basic types are making up the human body. So these are the ones. So what are the four different types? There are the epithelial tissues, connective tissues, muscle tissues, nervous tissues. Epithelial tissues create a protective boundaries in all the cells, have a, like wherever any organ is present, there we need the protection. There epithelial cells or tissues play a major role. Connective tissues, they underlie and support other tissue types. They form the junctions, they form the connections. Muscle tissues, they do the all the movements in the body. So these are the key tissues which help us to move our body parts and everything. And nervous tissue is another very important tissue which transmits all the signals, and the nervous systems getting maintained by this nervous tissue. Why this tissue is very important? Why we need to learn? Because these tissues are actually making this body structure fine. If any disruption in any tissue type, like if we get injured, there is a disruption in our tissues. So that will ultimately damage our whole system synchronization. So it will damage something which we can't even see, some internal damage, anything. So it's very, any disruption of the structure in a tissue can lead to injury or disease. If the damage persists, it will ultimately lead to the disease. We all get some bowel syndromes, we get some indigestion. So if any indigestion will be long, that means that epithelial, the gut system, is getting damaged. That will ultimately lead to the disease. We have to go for doctor and everything. So another part of tissue is very important, where tissues are also a valuable resource for medical research, diagnosis, test, biomarker, drug development, and everything. Why we need to learn this about the tissues? Because ultimately, when a human gets sick, we have to go to the hospitals, we have to get treated. So knowing the basics of human body is very much important. Then only we can treat them properly and get us cured. So tissues are actually the building blocks. So as I told earlier, the four primary tissues. So these are the types of tissues. First, I will talk about the epithelial tissues. Where the epithelial tissues lies? They lies in the lining of the GI tract organ and other organs in skin surface mainly. So each organ which has a skin surface kind of thing, they will have the epithelial tissues. Next, nervous tissues. Nervous tissues are in brain, spinal cord, nerves. We know we have all the nerves everywhere going. These are making connections. Muscle tissues. Muscle tissues has three different muscle tissues. Tissues are there. Cardiac, our heart is majorly dependent on these cardiac muscles. They have to behave properly. Otherwise, it's very important. So other smooth muscles and the skeletal muscles. And connective tissues, these are lots of tissues come under the connective tissues, which are like fat, from the fat cells to bone to tendon. So these four type of primary tissues, they make the whole body. All the organs is either in combination of four of them, or combination of two, or just a single one. So this is how the body gets formed. Now, what is the origin of the tissues? We all know that everything comes from an embryonic origin. That's a zygote or a fertilized egg. So when a egg and sperm get fertilized and we get the zygote, that's the basic of everything. The embryo cross section, if you do this, there is three different layers: endoderm, mesoderm, and ectoderm. So the zygote has nothing else. So it's the three layers, and those are omnipotent. Why we call omnipotent? The embryonic cells, they can generate to any type of cells in the body. So first the zygote, they have a different layers, and that layers will give rise to the different type of cells and organs. Like from ectoderm, we get the skin cell, neurons, pigment cells. From mesoderms, we get cardiac muscle, skeletal muscle, tuber cell of kidney, red blood cell, smooth muscles, and etc. And from endoderm, we get the lung cells, thyroid cells, and pancreatic cells. So only three basic layers, they are getting generated to all the different tissues, cells and tissues, ultimately organ. And like we have some of, that's why the young, when we start our life cycle from embryo to getting everything to, then all those, we have all the organs and all the regenerative processes going on. But when we get older, all these cells are getting depleted. So it's hard to get recovered from any of the damage of the tissues. So the, what are the function of the tissues? Each different type of tissues has different functions. Like epithelial cells, they cover body surface, and lines of internal organs. Connective tissues, they support and protection. Give protection. Nervous tissues, they sense and receives information about stimuli and muscles to movement. Ultimately, they can be classified into major function as of tissues: secretion, movement, strength, communication, and etc. Why it's important to know the function of tissues, and they have to behave at their function. Any problem in the function, they will ultimately give rise to the several other disease. And it's very much important to know what type of cells are there in a organ and what they do. Otherwise, the medical, in medical perspective, why it is very important, otherwise we can't detect where the problem lies if any of the function is not working properly. Like if someone is, heart is beating fast. So we don't know why the heart is beating fast. Either it's due to the heavy exercise or training or high blood pressure or anything. So we have to do several tests, and to know the each type of cells or tissues they are doing function properly, then only we can detect the problem if anything damage is there. Now coming to the damage, tissue injury is a major problem. Why this tissue injury comes into place? We get scars, the tissues get damaged. When it is external, we can see, but when it's internal, we can't see. So how this tissue injury happens? It can happen via several processes: inflammation, necrosis, apoptosis. We now, not a lot of people know about this apoptosis and inflammations. Apoptosis is programmed cell death, and necrosis is the accidental cell death. And what is the inflammation? Inflammation is anything, the initial response of the body injury. Due to the COVID situation, we all know a lot of things about the inflammations, how the immune cells are doing everything. So immune cells, they need, these are the first responders. Like if we do anything, the first responders come, the police and the doctors. That's why the inflammation, all the immune cells, they go there. They try to resolve the issues. They try to resolve the tissue injuries. But this, if the tissue injury is happening, so there is a chance that our organs are also getting damaged. So if it's the smallest or small injury that can be healed naturally, that's our body has. That's why we need a good immune system, good health, good diet and everything. Then our body heals by itself. But if it's a damage, it's a major injury, then we need to take help of the doctors and every other medicines, which will help the tissues to get recovered from the damage. Why this tissue damage is playing an important role? Like intestinal barrier system. So we take food and it goes by our digestive system. The digestive system is such a organ where it gets exposed to the external environment of the stimuli, which have the food and other, all the host, like microbes there. So if any damage in the gut barrier, like which is protecting us from the external foods, so what will happen? Not only the food materials will come into inside our body, but also the microbes will come inside the body. That's not required. So when the microbes will come inside the body, due to the loss of barrier integrity, then there will be increased inflammations. So that will cause the damage of the tissue. That when the our digestive system gets injured, we can't see. We will feel, oh, I'm not getting the food digestion properly or having something. So all these causes are the reason for the intestinal barrier dysfunction. So IBD, cancer, stress, alcohol, everything. So you have to be careful that you don't trigger those damage which you can't see. you are getting the disease right now, you might be able to know about it after 6 months or 1 year. So it's very important to know the if you are maintaining the good diet and having a healthy life. So there are now doctors are there and other treatments are there which will help to treat you. So there are several different techniques are available where there is a that will ultimately lead to the healing of the wounds. Here the tissue repairs play an important role. So when is the damage? So this is the artery and there are think that we got a damage where there is a scar. So how the tissue will get repaired? So once we get a scar, there is an inflammation of the immune cells. Inflammatory chemicals are released. There's a histamine. These are the chemical modulators or signals they come. They drag the other immune cells like white blood cells to visit the area. They examine where what happened and how much damage is done so that they can treat this healing naturally. So first the clotting occurs, which is helps to detach the blood vessels so that there can't be loss of blood and everything. Then only the fibroblasts. Actually, the fibroblasts play a major role in tissue repair. The epithelial cells multiply and they fill over the granulation tissue. So it's getting filled. And then ultimately restored epithelium thickness and area matches and contracts. So ultimately it is getting healed. So this is the tissue healing process and which should be done naturally when the injury is minimal. But when the injury is maximum, then there are some other helps which are needed. Now I will talk about the four types of tissues which I said earlier. That's the epithelial, connective, muscular and nervous tissues. As I told earlier, the epithelial tissues are very important. Then they are in the protective covering and inner lining of the body and organs. Epithelial tissues were first to evolve during the course of evolution. So the three, they can be generated from all the three layers I told earlier, from the germ layers, that's ectoderm, mesoderm, and endoderm. There are several different type of epithelial tissues are there and which have a different role. So the tissues can be either single layered or multi-layered. They can be closely packed, they can be loosely packed. They have these epithelial tissues hold a great power of regeneration. So in together, the epithelial tissues are a major tissue section of our body, which can be responsible for all smell, taste, hearing, vision, everything. They have a numerous activities in our body and have different functions. Another thing important, the free surface of the body, which include the outer surface of the internal organ, lining of body cavities, exterior surface of the body, tubes and ducts, everything will have these epithelial tissues. Now coming into the different classification of the epithelial tissues, they can be two types, simple, which have a single layer of the tissues, and another is stratified. That is the multi-layer of the tissues. So both the types will have squamous. This depends on the cell morphology. If you see the squamous tissues, they have a squamous-like structure, and the cuboidal, that is cube-like structure, and the column, that is column-like structure. So simple squamous epithelium, simple cuboidal epithelium, and simple columnar epithelium, same goes for stratified. And there is pseudostratified, which looks like a multilayer, but they are not. There are different shapes and size. Actually, each type of different epithelial tissue is present in a different place and different organs, depending on the... Hello? You can hear someone. Is anyone saying anything?
Dear student, please mute yourself.
So you please go ahead, Sita.
Yeah, sure. Each tissue, depending on the each region, and there are different types of cells present, and they have a different work, and to give us ultimate aim is to give us protection from the layers. Now that I talking about the epithelial cells, because we know that cells are making the tissues. Why epithelial cells are very important? because epithelial cells have a different what do you call it? Is an unequal distribution of organelles and membrane bound proteins between their apical and basal surface. What is apical surface? Apical surface is the top of any cells and basal surface is the bottom of the any surface. So structure found in the epithelial cells are adaptations of the specific function. So one epithelial cell can modify itself according to what functions it needs to be done. Like cilia are the extension of apical surface cell membrane that are supported by microtubules. These different cell epithelial cell structures, they are not only have different function but also different structural modules also. And they are getting connected with different type of junction. The cells of epithelial are closely connected with some limited extracellular material present. So each cell to cell has a need to be do a communication, right? So there are, and the cells, they are not leaky. If they get leaked, then it means damage. So they have a proper method of communication that they do via the junctional proteins. The junctional proteins can be tight junction, gap junction, and anchoring junctions. They are present in the different region of the cells. So tight junction, usually if there are two adjacent cells, then there can be gap junction, and it usually stays at the bottom, and the tight junction will be on top, and the anchoring junction is in between middle. So different type of junction, they some smaller molecules and the signals can pass through the junction, and that's how the cells within a tissue maintains the communication between themselves. So these are the important parameters of the maintaining the connection between the cells, between the epithelial cells. Now coming to the next type of tissue, that is connective tissue. Connective tissues are having lots of varieties. So connective tissue is one of the most abundant tissue types in the body. They're everywhere. So from the adipose, like fat deposits where we generate our lots of fats, from the cartilage, which is present in the bone itself, even the blood cells, comes under connective tissues. Why they're connective? They maintain the connections. In general, the connective tissues consists of cells and an extracellular matrix. Those all together generate the tissue and which maintains the connections, and with the three main components: cells, ground substance, and fibers. So connective tissues, as I told you, there are different type of connective tissues that can be broadly categorized into like four types. One is structural, fibroblast. I told about the fibroblast and the are very important for tissue repair. And there are also chondroblast and osteoblast. These are the important part for the bone generations. And immunological, there are plasma cells, leukocytes, eosinophils, all the immune cells, they are also connective tissues. And the defense also, their mast cell, basophils, macrophages, neutrophils, they are also a portion of connective tissue. And the energy reservoirs is the adipose cells where we deposit of the fats, which can be utilized as an energy resource in later time when body needs it. So these connective tissues are mainly on basis of the tissue fibers. These tissue fibers heal these connective tissues so that it can communicate. And these connective tissues actually present in either in collaboration with the epithelial cells or alone. So that fiber, these fibers helps in the maintenance of the connective tissues. There are collagen fibers, reticular fibers, and elastic fibers. Collagen fibers are the most abundant fiber type. They have a high tensile strength and is flexible. So it helps, the collagen fibers help to move, and they help into being the flexible. They can give a different shape and size and gives the tissue a unique characteristics. For example, type 1 collagen provides resistance to stretch in bone tissues, while type 4 collagen makes up the superstructure of the basement membrane. Another is reticular fibers. They are thinner than the collagen fibers. They have an extensive network and provide a structural support and framework. These things, as we know that these fibers can be stained, which can be visualized. So these reticular fibers cannot be stained in hematoxylin and eosin, and they need a silver stain to do this staining. And the last one is the elastic fiber. They provide us the elasticity. They are found in skin, blood vessel, and lung tissues. So this is how these connective tissue cells and the tissue fibers makes the connective tissues, which helps us to make the connection in between the different tissues. Now, these are the classifications of connective tissues. So connective tissues has different classification depending on the need and the structure of the tissues. One is connective tissue proper. These are the major classification, supportive connective tissues and the fluid connective tissues. Connective tissue proper, there were two different types. One is loose connective tissues and dense connective tissues. Loose connective tissues are they're loosely packed, and the dense are connective tissues are they're very tight in their structure, tissue structure. So areolar, adipose, and reticular are the loose connective tissues, and the dense connective tissues are regular, irregular, and elastic. So these connective tissues propers are like help in both like cell types and protein fibers substrated in viscous ground substances. Dense connective tissues are reinforced by the bundle of fibers that provide tensile strength, elasticity, and protection. And next is the supportive connective tissues, like fibrocartilage, elastic. These are the cartilages. They are helping the bones to form the tissue and give us the strength and the formation of the organs. So bone is another type of supportive connective tissues, which are the either compact bone or spongy bones. And the fluid connective tissues are blood and lymph. Blood has all the immune cells, even the lymph has. So the lymph and blood has a various specialized cells that circulate in a watery fluid containing salts, nutrients, and dissolved proteins. So these will hold all the immune cells, and they will form the connections from inside our body to provide an immunological response. So this is how the connective tissue works. Now coming to, I will talk about the muscle tissues. So muscle tissues are characterized by properties of that allow movement. So any movement, that's because of the muscle tissues. But there are three major type of muscle tissues are there: skeletal, smooth muscles, and cardiac muscles. Cardiac muscles are everything about heart. They needs to beat. They help in the beating. They are making those heart function, and that's the basic of the one of the major important part of the human body. Smooth muscles and skeletal muscles, these are also very much some muscles. These muscle contractions and the muscle work that are under control of our whole system. So if any problem in this muscle work, then that will be a major problem. So the comparison between the structure and properties of the muscle tissue. Skeletal, what is the skeletal? These are the first one is the skeletal muscle. So these are the long cylindrical fiber tissues, and they have a function on the voluntary movement that protects all the organs. So our all organs are protected by the skeletal muscles. So if we get any kind of bump or anything, so that our organs are not getting damaged, so our skeletal muscles are holding it and giving us the protections. Their location is attached to the bones and around and exit all the body, mouth, anus, everywhere. The cardiac muscle, I talked about this. This is the cardiac muscles, which are like short, branched, straighted, and single central nucleus. These helps in the contraction of the pump to pump the blood. So whole heart is made of these cardiac muscles. And the smooth muscles, these are the another short spindle-shaped muscles. They are in the ovals of the major organs and the passageways. So they help in the involuntary movement of the food and the control of respiration, all the secretions and everything. So this is how the different type of muscles which help us to provide the muscle tissues and giving us a function. Now coming to the fourth type of tissue, that is nervous tissue. Nervous tissue is characterized as being excitable and capable of sending and receiving electrochemical signals that provides the body with information. So two type of cells that make a nervous tissue, one is neuron and another is neuroglia. Neurons actually send, this is the neuron, so it has this is the axon region. This is where it gets connected with the other cells, and this is where, these are the dendrites from where they transmit the signals. They actually send, the neurons propagate the information by electrochemical impulses that is called as action potentials, which are biochemically linked to release of a chemical signals, the neurotransmitters. Now, by which these neurons send signals from one neuron to another, which do all the connections and the nerves. That is where our, from brain to all the body, how all the signals are getting transmitted daily. And neuroglia, they play an essential role in supporting the neurons. So neurons are actually having a large cell body. So this is called as a soma, where there is a larger portion also. And axons are the one which is protected by the myelin sheath, and they send the impulse right away from the soma to the dendrites and carrying the incoming information. Neurons are mostly easily identified. Their axons are either in the longitudinal or the cross-sectional side. Groups of neurons are referred as a ganglia at the peripheral nervous system and the nuclei of the central nervous system. So this is a nervous tissue, and we can see the neurons can be seen here. This is where they send the signals. And glia are the supporting cells in the nervous system. So the astrocytes are another part of the microglial cells, and the astrocytes are the part of the glia system. These cells differ by the region of the nervous system, and they support the neurons to send the synapse and the electrochemical signals. And there are also Schwann cells. These are also present in the specific region of the neurons. They are also helping the sending the signals from one neuron to another neuron. So from the brain to blood and all the signals, wherever the brain receives a signal, it needs to transmit. That's how is the all the signals and nervous tissue is getting transmitted. So we have talked roughly about the four different types of the tissues which are making the major part of the bodies. So there are some key facts about the tissue types. That's for this is reading. So the epithelial tissues, connective tissue, muscle tissue, and the nervous tissue each have different features. They have different subtypes, and they do a different work. But ultimately, end point is to make a synchronized human body which can function properly. Now, as we learned about the tissues, it's very important to visualize the tissues. Tissues can be seen, right? So all the, why tissue is, why they seeing this tissue is important. So if you are having any damaged tissue, we can't identify it with open eyes. We can't see it in the naked eyes. So it needs to be stained properly. There is a staining system. Now all of us know about the staining, how to color it, and there are different stains available. So tissues can get sectioned. So these tissue sections can be stained and can be visualized. So each tissue has a different, has a specific morphology. So if we can determine the morphology is not the ideal one, which is like a theoretical one, then we understand there is a damage, somehow any problem. If someone is having a cancerous growth or any damage, that can be easily seen via this tissue section. That is called as a histology and histopathology. Histology is a field of study that involves a microscopic examination of the tissue appearance, organization, and function. The structure of each tissue is directly related to its function. So histology is related to anatomy and physiology. Histology can be of normal tissues. So all the tissues have a specific type, and they will have a special histology. When the term comes as a histopathology, when these sections are getting used to determine if a person is affected by a disease or not. Like this picture, this is a micrograph of a cervical tissues. here you can see that the abnormal epithelium. These are the normal epitheliums, which is a like nice epithelial cells are grouped together. But we can see there is these things are not the exact normal epithelium. These are some abnormal epithelium. That's the cancerous growth. So these histopathology of these tissue sections giving us the idea that there is a cervical cancer in this tissue. So that is how this histopathology is very important. Whenever we get, we all now know about the biopsies and other things that people take tissues out from your body, they stain it, they visualize it under microscope, and they determine if you are having a normal body or some problem is happening in your tissues. So if any problem, then proper treatments can be done, and that gives us a better health and better life. Now, as we learned about the tissues, and now we have to learn what is the tissue biology impact in our research. Why we are so much interested on this tissue biology in the research perspective. So these are the epithelial tissues we learn. That's what our body have. So when we do, we all know about the cells, right? We culture them in plates. So that's a standard 2D models. Where the cells grow, we are thinking, okay, these cells, they are going to do the same work and they will give us an idea of what the cells are doing in our body. But inside of the body, the situation is different. There are several other cell types. Each cell types have a different work, and like the GI tract or the heart. So they're not just a single tissue, like single cell or single cell type. There is a mixture of tissue. There are connective tissues, there are smooth muscles, there are other things which makes a organ. So it's very important to know the tissue as such so that it can mimic our real system. So where it comes as a novel 3D approaches, where researchers are trying to generate certain tissues in lab, where these are the 3D tissues, like these are called as the organoids, spheroids, or organochip. So the main impact is to mimic the human body or the organ more. So these are the schematic representation of the epithelial tissue with an native 3D architecture, which is present in our body. This is the conventional 2D cell structure, and this is the novel 3D cell culture approaches, where they are more similar to the real world, not that standard, the initial how we started research about those only cell cultured in plates. So this 3D approach is more relevant in today's world. So here comes the tissue organoids. Why organoid? The organoid terms is very much related to the organs. So now researchers are trying to generate those organs in the lab itself. It's hard to generate having the organ which will behave all similar to whatever we have human body. But to know the organs more, it's very important to have different type of cells present together in a module, so that we can understand better about the function of the those tissues and the organs. So the various models are now being developed to better understand the human organs, including the simplified version of the tissue grown in a dish from a stem cells. We know the stem cells are the initiator of the all the tissues. So ultimately, if we can start from the scratch, where in our case it started from the zygote. So if we are having those stem cell in the dish, and we can give the specific, the required stimulations which is needed for to generate the organs, then these tissues can be generated. Actually, people are doing it. So these can be generated, which are more relevant. We know we do the animal studies as the you are learning the zoology. So all the people do any medicine get produced, they taste it on the mice. Initially the cell cultures, they test it on the mice, then higher, even the for the COVID vaccines. So it has a different trials. Ultimately, it goes to the human. So this is better to have something which is more relevant to the human system. So this organoids are playing. This is trick, the connection between the human and animal model, where these organoids are giving us more precise functions of the human organs. So engineering the human tissue is hard. It has certain other requirements for is to generate is not an easy thing. So it needs the primary cell line, stem cell, then the organoids will get generated. That's the cell portion. Now it needs scaffolds. What is scaffolds? Where the tissue will stand. So in our body, it has a specific region. So for that, to engineer a tissue or organ in vitro system, so it also needs the scaffold, the hydrogels, or the 3D printing system. Plus, it needs the all the niche properties, which is the DNA, RNA, all the growth factors, protein, nanoparticles, everything. So now the researchers have the main aim to generate certain tissues which is more relevant to the human body and where we can trace our drugs. So any new medicine is coming. So if it is getting tested on the animals, what a mouse is going to react about the drug, it's better to we know if we have some organs, if we're treating a heart with a specific drug. So if we have an organoid of heart, that will give us a better effect. That's the main point. So engineering a human tissue equivalent is very important, and nowadays many researchers or all those things are getting done in terms of the tissue organoids. So this is the current trends in tissue biology. So this is a simplified, this is a simplified 3D brain organoid that can be grown in the dish using human stem cell as a starting material. So the tiny ones, these are tissue culture plate, and these are the simple 3D brain organoid. So that might not be the exact the brain what we are thinking about is in our head, but this is the smallest unit or the mimic of those brains. And this is a researcher dissecting the sides of human brains tissue. So they need to learn. Then brain is a more complex thing, so the more they have to learn, so they have to, we can't dissect a human brain directly, right? So we need the either the dead ones or these organoids to learn more about it, because it's a more complex system. So these organoids are helping the researchers or the doctors to know more about the tissue and thus their function in our human body. And plants, they're also helping us to generate the human tissues. Yes, this is the apple, and this is the ear grown from an apple. So this is the, actually not the apple itself, they generated the ear. This is the human cells only, but the scaffold, which is I told earlier, this is there is a need of the scaffold, which holds that tissue cells to generate a specific architecture or type. So you can see this is apple scaffold. What the researchers did, it actually happened in, I think, 2018. So they removed the apple cells, all the plant cells, DNA, all the biomolecules. They left them with the fibrous scaffold and put the human cells in it and like hand-drawed the texture. And they found after some time, it took the shape of the ear. And eventually they transferred the ear to the mice and they have a rodent body, and they found that the cells, these ears can be, it can be connected with the blood vessels inside the rodent body and it starts working. So many new things to be done yet, which we don't know when will happen, but it has started. Why this is important? Because if something is getting damaged, we know there is a transplantation and everything, but many people die or many people have many problems which can't be resolved just with the transplantation or with the medicine. So any organ need to be replaced. If we can generate such organ from the tissues, and that will help the humans very much, and that will do a miracle in the doctor system, in our health system. But the most difficult questions are also coming, that if the human organs are starting to function, then what will happen to the brains we will grow in our petri dishes? Will they think or they not? Let's see. That is a lot of more work to do. Hope that will benefit the human health system. So these are for the reference. You can study the molecular biology of cell, atlas of human histology. And another thing, do read research reviews on topic of interest. Just give a Google search with whatever you are liking. There are like really good reviews. Maybe you need to learn about tissue, give a search, tissue reviews. So we'll keep you updated about what recent findings are there in your topic of interest. Thank you.
That's a very interesting presentation, Shweta. So I think we came to know a lot about the recent trends in the tissue research as well as the basic science. So I would like to request the students, to if they have any questions, please ask and interact with the speaker.
Yeah, sure.
Yes, ma'am. I have a question that will you share these materials with us?
Sure.
Later on.
Yeah, okay. Sure. I think I will give it to Dr. Shandash Bandhabandhan, and he can share it with you guys.
Yes, okay, please. Just forward it to me, the PDF copy, and I can share it to the student.
I will.
If you have more questions, please ask.
Madam, I have a question that during discussion of characteristics of skeletal and cardiac muscle, we see that they are stated. So if you discuss about what is stated, then it is helpful.
They are stated?
I think they are striated or something.
Stratified was there. So the different type of the cells are making the tissues, right? So if the cell has a different morphology, that's why these are the terms. The stratified terms means that is on epithelial tissues, as far as I remember. So these are like multi-layered. So this is a term to distinguish between the single layer or multi-layered.
Okay.
Hello, ma'am. I have a question.
Sure.
You have said that the embryonic cells are omnipotent in nature. Mm-hmm. What is the difference between omnipotent and totipotent?
Omnipotent and totipotent is omnipotent can generate to any type of cells, but the totipotent, they have a specific, they're already one step ahead. So from the totipotent, not all cells can be generated, some specific. Where it has, the lineage has started, it will generate that type of only. But the omnipotent, where all, every material is raw, so any type of cells or tissues can be generated from those cells, omnipotent stage.
Okay, ma'am, thank you.
Do you, if you have more questions, you can ask, otherwise we'll need to conclude the session. Okay, I think we do not have any more questions. So Dr. Saroj Ghosh will express the vote of thanks. Please, Dr. Ghosh.
Yes, Dr. Bandhopadhyay. On behalf of the Zoological Association of Burdwan, we extend our wholehearted thanks to you, madam, for accept our invitation and spend your precious time in the online lecture series for undergraduate studies in zoology. We are delightful to you for your admired lecture and enlightening your valuable knowledge with us. The structural organization of tissue is very important for any kind of investigation. Without architecture and characteristics of tissue, it is not possible for going any sort of exploration. I think your esteemed talk on tissue will be adequate for our students in their academic arena. Thanks to my beloved students for attending the lecture. Thank you, everybody. Have a nice day. With these few words, I conclude the session.
Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure to